My name is Hrönn Marinósdóttir and I'm the festival director of the Reykjavík International Film Festival.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for taking time out of your schedule. I really appreciate that. The Reykjavík International Film Festival, tell us about where it started and how it started.
It started in 2004, so the festival is now 11 years old. Actually, I'm the founder of the festival. It was a small group of film enthusiasts who decided to start the festival in 2004. The main reason was to increase film culture in Iceland. We felt a little bit like the selection of films in the general cinemas is limited, and actually in Iceland the cinemas are owned by the distributors, so gradually through the years what the distributors make the most profit of is to screen films that come from Hollywood. Those are great films, but it's not the whole world, so that is sort of what we wanted to change. And I had been a journalist before. I was working for newspaper, and I got the chance to travel. I went to, for example, to the Berlinale, which is one of the biggest festivals in Europe, and I experienced there a very special atmosphere. I felt like, even though I didn't go to the cinemas, you knew there was something special going on, a big film event, and that sort of influenced me when we started the festival in Reykjavík, that we wanted to really make the city come sort of alive through film.
Bring the culture together, bring the spirit, bring the energy that festival brought there, bring it here for
exactly,
the Icelandic
that
people.
That was sort of like the role model. That was my experience. And I had also been living in Barcelona, and close to my home there was a little cinema which was screening a lot of different films from all over the world. And that time we didn't have that in Reykjavík. Now we have one, which is called Bio Paradise. But so that was something that I really felt like was missing. And then soon we found out that Reykjavík is a popular destination. It can be, of course, the nature is what the people come to see in Iceland. But I mean, I think it is a bonus because the whole world is traveling so much now. And Iceland has become so popular, so it's good, this cultural tourism, you know. Mm-hmm. So you go to see the Golden Circle, you take the Golden Circle trip, which is the most popular, and then there is something cultural going on as well. Mm-hmm. And actually we found soon out that there are so many travelers who enjoy visiting the festival as well, and we have tourist groups coming from abroad especially for this event. So it was to change the film culture, bring films from Europe that was not possible to see before, and then also make the city of Reykjavík and in fact Iceland a known film festival country. Right. That is what we've been working on very, very hard for all this time.
What kind of challenges now have you seen along the way, and what triumphs have you seen? I mean, the reception is obviously very, very good. Yeah. You just said people cater their vacations around the festival itself.
Yeah.
What challenges have you seen when you started this 10 years ago?
When I started this 10 years ago, it was in the beginning, many people said, this is not going to work.
They always say that.
Yeah, that's what they said, and they told us that, I mean, young people are not interested in this kind of independent cinema making. They only want to see the Hollywood productions. But we proved them wrong, because the majority of the audience is very young people in college. But what has been the greatest challenge is, I think, to finance it. It's not a very entertaining subject or topic to talk about.
But it's a real topic. I mean, that's the full of it.
Yeah,
you have to make sure it continues.
Exactly. So that has been sort of a challenge because we had the crisis in Iceland, as you know, a few years ago.
Yeah.
So actually in 2008, the day after the festival finished in the beginning of October, and the day after the Prime Minister, Mr. Geir Horte, he went on TV and he said this famous sentence, God bless the nation, you know.
Yeah.
So, and then nobody knew what would happen. So we went on a big roller coaster ride with this Iceland, us in general, and also us, because our founding sponsors were big companies that most of them went just totally bankrupt. So we sat down and we thought, okay, so what should we do? Is this the end of the Reykjavik International Festival or should we continue? And that is actually what we did. We had to think about a different strategy on how to run it. And we managed to do so, and I'm very proud of that because, yeah, the festival is actually... Every year we manage to run it non-profit, of course. We make it work.
Right.
And that is one reason how we make it work is that we, instead of getting money from companies, for example, we get service. So we work with a lot of companies in Iceland who give us all kinds of service, like DHL is helping us, you know, with bringing the films to Iceland.
Yep.
And we have a big production company called Saga Film, which is helping us with, for example, inviting our guests to take a tour, location scouting tour, and they lend us equipment for production and so on. And what is also changed is that we have so many volunteers working for the festival, because we found out it was a nice surprise that there are so many young people around the world who wanted to come and help us out, you know, not getting paid for it. So that is like one of the characteristics of this festival, I think, is perhaps also in Toronto and in many other places, but this is not very common in Iceland, that you have international volunteers coming only to work at this event.
Amazing.
It is, and it like, so you go to the ticket sale office and you meet a Japanese girl or a guy from Tunis or... somebody from Belgium, you know, it makes it even more international.
Right.
The characteristics of the city is how you describe it. It's young and it's like sort of powerful and it's a little bit...
It's energetic.
Energetic, yeah. And a little bit rocky. It's like, you know, that is sort of the feeling of Reykjavik, I think, because when we were starting the festival, actually, we thought, what kind of city? It's so important when you start an event like this. You think, what kind of environment is it that you are thinking about having this event in? So we studied a lot the cultural strategy of the city of Reykjavik. What do they want? What do they think is fit to have in a city such as Reykjavik? And so I definitely think that the festival was shaped in accordance to what the environment. We have a competition section which is only devoted to young filmmakers, young progressive filmmakers, because we thought that would sort of harmonize the environment,
right.
the city and the strategy of the city.
Right.
And the young people, yes, I think that is helping us because Reykjavik has this image and then they think the festival must be something similar.
Because wherever movie stars go and directors go, it's going to be energetic.
That's true.
It's going to be energetic.
Yeah, that's true.
What have you seen evolve since the start of this festival as far as style has been concerned from Icelandic filmmakers? Has it been darker at the beginning, more funny now? Has it been more dramatic? Has it been more dramatic now than before?
Yeah.
Horror?
I see what you mean.
What has evolved?
I think, I mean, the Icelandic filmmaking, the industry is rather small. So every year it's only approximately 4 to 6 feature films that are made. Mm-hmm. And a little more of documentaries. So it's like, it varies a lot. I mean, I don't think there is one characteristics in general. I don't think that's fair to say that. But I think what we try to do is to invite filmmakers that are provocative in a way. For example, last night we had a Q&A with a Swedish film director called Ruben Östlund, who is a young filmmaker. And he is our emerging master this year. And he has made a few films. The latest one is called Force Major or Tourist and was premiered in Cannes. He's always challenging people. And he's always, his films are maybe a little bit difficult.
They're uncomfortable.
A little bit uncomfortable.
But they get that threshold going.
You think. Exactly. And I think it was very inspiring to listen to him at this Q&A last night because he was sort of, in a way, challenging the Icelandic filmmakers to go out of the nice box.
Comfort zone.
And to do something that is, you know, and he feels like that is sort of, his, maybe not his role, or at least he wants to make films because he wants to make this world a better place, and he thinks cinema is, and films are, can really change the world, you know, and so his last film is about the success, or, you know, the relationship between a man and a woman, mm-hmm. and all the conflicts that...
There's conflicts there?
There are lots of conflicts.
Wow, that's amazing.
And I think it was like, I told him that this is, you actually hit the your finger on the right spot there, because this is really something that people are discussing and thinking about. And then we screened also last night his film Play, which is about discrimination about immigrants mm-hmm. in Swedish
that's
society.
A big deal,
And the way, I mean, it was a difficult film to watch, but I thought it was so important. And I felt like, okay, this is a film I want to show my kids even, because, And I think, I hope Icelandic filmmakers are sort of get inspired and
push the boundary.
Push the boundary and try something new.
Why do you think this festival has become so popular?
Well, we have a specific focus on documentaries, and actually almost half of the program is documentaries. And news on TV,
current
affairs is always getting shorter and shorter. So there's something going on in the world, and there's an interview or something is being described, and one anchor has maybe 1 or 2 minutes to describe what's going on in the world.
Right.
But I think Icelandic audience is sort of thirsty for knowledge. They really want to know what's going on in the world. And Iceland is a little bit isolated, small island in the north. Even though we sometimes think we are in the middle of the universe, I mean, we think that we are really there,
right.
And that is maybe one reason why everything happened with the crisis and all, because we thought maybe
we
were
the only ones, maybe
the new generation of Vikings, But anyway, I think that is one reason why the festival is so popular. Is that we are screening films that really matters. Entertainment is an important factor, but also to get more knowledge. And
To make you think. Because as a former journalist, you can appreciate the fact that you do only have 2 minutes, and anchor has 2 minutes to tell a story.
That's true.
And then he or she can go from devastation to a lost dog in a minute.
That's true.
But if you have the ability to, if you have the canvas to tell a bigger story, and you have a smart audience that wants to learn the story, then you're going to have that experience.
I think so,
But talk about the overall experience. Speaking of experience, the Reykjavik International Film Festival, what can people expect when they come here? What kind of experience? Besides just watching the movies, what can people expect to find that you wouldn't be able to find maybe at another international film festival?
Well, there are a few things that I think make Reykjavik a special festival. It's the New Vision section. It's the 12 competition films that are sort of progressive, and it's like our trademark in a way. It's like first and second directors that are competing for the Golden Puffin. And it's the film program, especially that section, and also the documentaries. But we also have different side events, and I know they have been very popular, especially from people from abroad, because we bring cinema in a different perspective. So, for example, we take people to the swimming pool, and not only to swim, but also to see a film, So when you go swimming, you can expect a screen.
There's a swim-up bars, now there's swim-up theaters.
Yeah, exactly.
Amazing.
So we have a swim-in, which is quite nice. And then, I mean, we have a drive-in, and sometimes we even organize film screenings in caves. And you go for a walk to the shopping streets, and we have film programs in the hair salons and in the small boutiques and in the library and so on.
So you're surrounded.
We are surrounded, and the reason why we do that is, number one, to get more audience. Certain amount of people that are used to go to the cinema and want to go to the cinema, but we want to expand, we want to develop our audience, so we decided to go to unusual places like the swimming pools to get more people to come
to get more people interested, to attract more
exactly
audience.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a director also that invited an audience to his home
exactly every year we
every
do
year,
that
yeah
yeah, yeah. So we sometimes we do a lot of it. This year there's one of the oldest Icelandic directors, Hrafn Gunnlaugsson, who is inviting to his home. We think it's like, that is funny. Icelanders' home are rather big, I mean, because of the weather, when we meet our family and friends, we often invite them to our homes. We are sort of proud of our homes. We put a lot of effort in having nice houses, mm-hmm. you know. So that is sort of a tradition. So we thought, okay, this is something that we have to somehow expose to the foreigners that come. So we ask certain film directors and other people to open their doors so you can walk in and you can see a film and, you know, talk to the filmmakers. And,
amazing. Yeah. In their own home.
In their own home,
that's a lot of trust.
It is, yeah, yeah.
My last question. Given all the things that, you know, you've been through, the challenges, it would never happen. And then the economic crash, what are we going to do?
Yeah.
What's the future hold for the Reykjavik International Film Festival? Where do you guys go from here?
I think we have actually many possibilities to develop. And I think we are here to stay because, I mean, every year the attendance is growing. I think we will sort of keep in the same track as the amount of films. But we just want to stay in the forefront and of Nordic film festivals and,
go from there.
And go from there. In the beginning, when we were starting the festival, we decided to, because we didn't have the knowledge in Iceland on how to build a film festival of this size, of this caliber. So I got into contact with professionals, and one of them was a lady who used to run the Toronto International Film Festival for many years, mm-hmm. and we found out that she has Icelandic ancestors. Her name is Helga Stefansson, mm-hmm. and actually she came to the first event, and we asked her to give a talk about how can film festivals influence societies, mm-hmm. and she did that very well. And since then, she has been sort of my mentor in this, she is my mentor in this field,
in this endeavor, yeah.
and she's the chair of the festival. So she comes every year. We also had on our team Peter Wintonik, who was a Canadian producer and a programmer. He mm-hmm. passed away, mm-hmm. unfortunately, a few months ago. But he was replaced by Chris McDonald, who is the president of Hot Dogs.
Okay.
And he is helping us selecting the documentaries every for this selection.
So you've got a great crew. You've got a great crew helping.
Yeah, yeah. And one of our main programmers is Italian. And he's working for the Venice Film Days as well. Okay. Giorgio Cosetti is his name. Mm-hmm. And I think that is important to, you know, and that is why we have managed to get so many good films to, mm-hmm. and new films to Iceland, because we have
a great crew.
We have a great crew.
With an international flavor that you're able to learn from different cultures
exactly.
and different approaches.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Well, and now you're just hoping that the Icelandic filmmakers push the boundary a little bit.
I think that would be so nice. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you so much for joining me today. I understand you're very busy, and I wish you all the best of luck, not just this year, but for the many years to come.
Thank you very much, Jim. It's a pleasure to meet you.